Namo Narayanaya. Om Namo
Narayanaya.
Om Namo Narayanaya. Om Namo Narayanaya.
Om Namo Narayanaya.
Om Namo Narayanaya.
Om Namo Narayanaya.
Om Namo Narayanaya. Pratibodhitam Narayanena Swayam Vyasena Grathitam Purana Munina Mahabharatam Advaitam Ritavarshinim Tim Ashtadashadhyayinim Ambhatva Manusandadhami Gite Bhavadveshini Namostute Vyasa Vishala Buddhe Pullara Vindayata Patra Netra Yenatvaya Bharata Taila Purnaha Prajvalito Jnanamaya Pradipaha Prapanna Parijataya Totra Vetraika Panaye Jnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gita Amrita Duhe Namaha Tatra Kapari Devana. Why cry over what is unavoidable, what is the law of nature? Why cry over the inevitable? Shri Krishna says, all along it has been so. Living beings appear for a while and then disappear. Those who are born have to die, and those who die are born again. Though the second part, for those who do not believe, is more a proposition or hypothesis. The first part is what everybody knows as the law of nature. Everything that is born dies. In science too, they say what dies takes another form, but they do not have the concept of the soul. Just on the planes of matter and energy, they have what we call the law of conservation. Law of conservation of energy in one domain, that energy cannot be destroyed, it only changes form. And law of conservation of matter in another domain. Then at some point of time, they found out matter and energy are interchangeable. Therefore, whatever you call matter slash energy is indestructible. But the philosophers or the Vedantins, spiritualists ask the question, you say matter or energy is indestructible. What about the intelligence that found it all? How reasonable is it to propose that this intelligence which found the laws of matter or energy is itself destructible? It must be of a far higher order of existence. Therefore, chetana, chaitanya or spirit in the first place has to be indestructible. So, if it dies, that's only in the eyes of the onlooker, it is born again. Dhruvam janma mritasya cha avyaktadini bhutani avyakta nidhananyeva. Before they are born, we don't know. Avyakta. Vyakta is very clear, express, explicit, manifest. A child is born in a house, they do not know where from this child came. If you again believe in the soul, otherwise it is all matter. With respect to the mere physical body, even Vedanta works, scriptures say, Mata Pitra Malodbhutam, such an expression also is used somewhere. When somebody is very attached to a physical body, it is said that it is just born of decaying matter. Every body is decaying matter. This is called Sharira Ninda, censure of the physical body, to which we do get terribly attached. Our own body, the bodies of our spouses or children or near and dear ones, as is evident from instances when someone dies, if that person was very dear to you, if you are very attached to that person, for very long you remain in the grip of thoughts of that person. There was some young man who died in an accident, just 22 years old or so, on a highway. And the father, for following 1 or 2 years, every Sunday would drive to that spot, park the car by the side of the highway, just stay there for an hour or two and come back home. The father was so attached to the son. Which son? That form, that figure, that image. Then there was this professor who had published many papers, himself a PhD, and had guided many PhDs in the renowned Indian Institute of Science. And his, again, 18-year-old son drowned in some lake near Bangalore and passed away. Some of us had gone to the house of the professor. We conducted a bhajan session because that son was member of the Chinmaya Yuva Kendra. We thought the father would receive us, say a few words of appreciation, you youngsters. I was young those days. This is an old story. So I too was young once. So we thought the father would receive us at the door, compliment us, give a beautiful speech at the end with a mic in hand. I am so proud of youngsters of Bangalore. My son had such good friends, I did not know, but today I see his friend circle. We are all ready for receiving compliments. Stupid ones as we were. We went with harmonium and tabla and ready with many bhajans, you sing this, I'll sing that, and so on. so immature we were that occasion, though he was one, I mean I was not one of the young Yuvakendra members, I was their guide, study group, Yuvakendra, you know, coordinator. But the group members were all, you know, 20, 22 years old, I was 31 or something. So we went. We could not believe such a distinguished professor of the Indian Institute of Science called Tata Institute in Bangalore was not found anywhere at the door. Even as we went in, the boy's mother said, come, come, and made us sit. We were wondering, where is the father, the professor? Then we found on the corner of that long hall, there was a cot. And there was something there covered with a cloth. And then we saw it was shaking in between. Then the mother went and lifted the blanket and said to the husband, the boys have come, boys and girls of Chinmaya Yuvakendra have come, they are going to sing bhajans. Like a child, that man cried and moved on the bed, like, you know, a little child crying inconsolably. But this child was pretty long, 5.5 feet long. Otherwise, one of us would have lifted the child in our arms. Romat, you know. But this child, he was a professor, distinguished, well-known professor. Maybe he was so good in his subject, but with regard to his only son, his attachment was so intense. So he had become like a child. You know, not even sleeping, you know how, crouched, you call it, what do you call it, curved, and crying loudly. And all, we sang, all through the bhajan, he did not come out at all. In between, he would open the blanket a little bit and see, again cover, and he went on crying. We are highly attached to the form without realizing that the one over there is not that form. Forms come and go. Vyakta madhyani, the forms, madhya, in the middle, appear. Our own forms will not stay forever, they go. Therefore, in Zen Buddhism, they have a koan, puzzle, which is spiritually educative. They ask you, first they prepare your mind. Think of your face when you are 10 years old. With some difficulty, you are able to remember a little bit at least. Maybe these days children can remember more because there are more photographs. In the good old golden days of ours, I mean for these children, their childhood was golden days. So let me just say good old days. In good old days, photography itself was so less rather. So many of us do not remember our face so well. Because what we see in the mirror, we do not remember. If there are pictures of our own, leave alone childhood, if some of us are trying to, suppose some of us are 50, we are trying to remember how we were at 35. It's difficult, we don't remember what we saw in the mirror. But if we have some photographs with us, we see that again and have some idea. Otherwise, no. So, in Zen Buddhism, they have this question. Imagine your own face when you are 10 years old, okay? Imagine your own face when you are 5 years old. More difficult, and yet you manage to. And finally, imagine how your face was 10 months before you were born. 10 months before you were born, how was your face? You cannot even imagine with your knowledge of science the embryo and so on. Even the embryo was not formed. You have no face to face this question. This koan, Zen koans are meant to throw you into stillness, into a puzzled state of mind. In that thoughtless condition, the Zen gurus do weird things. Even as you are wondering, how was my face when I was minus 10 months old? The Zen guru may come and slap you. Sometimes I believe realization takes place by this slap therapy, slap technique. The Zen gurus are known for all such sorts of. Even in Vedanta also such instances have been there, when gurus puzzle the student, say to him weird things, and thereby sending that mind to a non-judgmental condition. Otherwise, our mind at the easiest opportunity, at the slightest opportunity, takes a position of judgment. Who she is, good or bad, who he is, good or bad, what I am, good or bad, successful or failure, come to an opinion, sit there comfortably. Remain firm in opinion, in conclusion. Moksha requires that you let go of all conclusions. Every conclusion is a confusion, according to the Vedanta. No conclusion, therefore no confusion. To say, I don't know, is blissful. So when they asked Krishnamurti, what do you think of Rajneesh? His answer was, I don't think of Rajneesh. How sweet. State of no opinion. There is some famous book, I have not read it, but it's a famous book in this such literature. The Cloud of, anyone knows? Oh, it's a classic, I suppose a Christian classic, but comes close to the Vedanta. Therefore, many Vedanta students talk about it. Somebody gave me a copy also of that book. The Cloud of Unknowing. Not knowing, the Cloud of Unknowing. I don't know what that book had. I kept it in my shelf and made several plans when to read it, how to read it, how many pages per day, all that. One fine day I found after 3 or 4 years that book left me. The book was disappointed with me. You only make plans, you never read me. So the book disappeared from my shelves. I should get it back again. But there is, if you get a chance, collect it. The Cloud of Unknowing, it's supposed to be a classic with lot of Vedanta-like insights, Vedanta-like sayings. Vyakta Madhyani Bharata. In all our relationships, a verse like this can be very helpful. Whenever we are very attached to somebody, we must remind ourselves, this is the Madhya. Sometime back we did not know her. Sometime later we will not know her. This is Vyakta Madhya. Madhya means in the middle. If we think that this Madhya, the middle, will not have an end, she and I or he and I, she and we, he and we, will always be holding hand in hand and dancing eternally till the sun, moon and stars keep shining. There is no greater foolishness than that. All relationships begin and end. Then you are born alone, you will die alone, in between you will feel more alone. This verse, therefore, brings about great non-attachment in us, if we reflect upon it. And non-attachment, the very word non-attachment, the very prospect of non-attachment makes many of us turn very grim. Should I give up my attachments? Are we going to lose our best friends? Are we going to part from our best associations? Is that the message of Gita? We cry. The proposal of Vairagya is always very, very saddening. But the other way if you look at it, Vairagya itself is the, what do you call it, harbinger of bliss. Vairagya Samrajya it is called. You are an emperor when you have Vairagya. But when you are in Raga and Vairagya is proposed, it's the last thing that you want. You are attached and you are told to be not attached. When you actually get non-attached, that is the most blissful one. Then you don't want attachment. When you are here, you don't want to go there. After having gone and settled there, you don't want to come back. Both are strange scenarios. Parents normally try this when their son gets attached to a girl whom he loves and they don't love. They want him to marry the girl whom they love, right? So, the one of the standard techniques all over the world, more so in our country, because we are more attached to our son. Our attachment is all life. Our mothers, our fathers say, my son is very young, he is not able to take his own decisions, he is only 63. Therefore, for a little more time we need to be with him, hold his hand. That is our culture, to hold his hand, to hold her hand, till death, what is that, doth us part. Death? Thank you. That's marriage vows, I think, in Christianity. Till death do us apart. Our relation with our children, the gurus also are like that. They don't want to part with students. Students also are, they don't want to part with gurus. Upar wala dekh raha hai. And then he does something. Children and parents, brothers and sisters, gurus and students, you name it. All relationships, they are there for some time, then they go. I was telling about parents. They typically do some conspiracy and see that either the boy is far away for a year or two, or the girl is far away for a year or two. Suppose I have a son and he is in love with some girl. This caste problem, some problem. I don't want this boy to, my son to be near her. Then I sponsor her education in England. If I all know her, I tell her, father, your daughter is such a wonderful girl and I have decided to sponsor her education. Usko Oxford bhej dijiye aap. They are all very happy. How generous of him. Later they find out that I sent that girl to Oxford because she was getting very close to my son, which I don't want. Everybody does that. But now with smartphones and all technology, sitting in Oxford, she is in more touch with my son than before. When she is here only in Bangalore, Mysore, Varanasi or somewhere, no. It was difficult. Now with Skype on and headphones on, everything, day and night. Even in attending classes in Oxford, she is doing BlackBerry messages to my son. Finally, it's frustrating. But when I am no more trying, I give up. One day they fight and then they send message to everybody. We both have decided to remain friends. That is the language these days. You see, again, it's not should but would. When they decide, however much you try, and there are, I don't want to, I know several stories here, but don't want to tell them. There are some instances where the parents who are opposing with all their might, at some point suddenly begin to like that girl or the boy. Suddenly something happens, then they want to go ahead with marriage, let us say. Exactly then these two fight and separate. Then the another drama starts. The parents very much want now to bring the two together, and they don't want. Kya circus hai? Is there a more, what shall we say, humorous or fascinating circus than your life? Not your life, our life. In the West they say, speak for yourself, don't say our, say my life. In the West they don't tolerate sometimes you generalizing. Suppose I am an engineer working in the West, and in some function I make a statement. You see, we engineers are like that. Another engineer gets up and says, speak for yourself. Say, I as an engineer am like that. Don't categorize, don't take the whole category. But you do not do that. Powerful statement, vyakta madhyani. So, as you know, there is a strong spiritual advice. Remember death always, then you will never have sorrow. Remember that you may die any time. Death is round the corner. There is a teaching. In the same way, this shloka, remember change always. Anything may change any moment. Then there will be no paridevana. Ascharyavat pasyati kaschidenam.
Ascharyavat pasyati kaschidenam.
Ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyaha.
Ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyaha.
Ascharyavat chainam anya shrunoti.
Ascharyavat chainam anya shrunoti.
Shrutvapyenam veda na chaiva kaschit. Together, Ascharyavat pasyati kaschidenam. Ascharyavat vadati tathaiva chanyah. Ascharyavat chainam anya shrunoti. Shrutvapyenam veda na chaiva kaschit. Dehi nitya nityamavadhyoyam.
Dehi nityamavadhyoyam.
Dehe sarvasya bharata.
Dehe sarvasya bharata.
Tasmat sarvani bhutani.
Tasmat sarvani bhutani.
Natvam shochitum arhasi.
Natvam shochitum arhasi.
Dehi nityamavadhyoyam.
Sarvasya bharata, tasmat sarvani bhutani, natvam shochitum arhasi.
The translation has been made quite thoughtfully, Gita Press, Gorakhpur. For this word pasyati can be taken in many ways. The translators here, as you have it in your hand, uses the expression perceive. Hardly any great soul perceives this soul as marvelous. Scarce another great soul likewise speak thereof as marvelous, and scarce another worthy one hears of it as marvelous, while there are some who know it not even on hearing of it. So, Ascharya, which sometimes is translated as wonder or surprise, here they have highlighted the scarcity, the rarity. Rarely one is able to perceive this. Or marvelous goes with ascharya. Kaschit, rare is implied. Rarely anyone knows this to be marvelous. It is so marvelous, it is indeed most fascinating. What? It means what? Your true nature, my true nature, her true nature. The soul is most marvelous, but hardly anyone perceives it as marvelous. Everyone has a very limited idea of the soul. Either the atheists do not think of the soul at all, they do not know there is a soul, they dismiss the soul. But those of us who believe in a soul also take it as nothing much to talk about. If there is anything to talk about, it is the beautiful body, it is the beautiful mind. We give Olympic gold to those who ran, those who jumped. For what is that running and jumping? According to these scriptures, it is the glory of the pranamaya kosha, energies. Swiftness is pranamaya kosha. So the achievements of pranamaya kosha, let's say Nobel Prize for economics or some chemistry, physics and so on, it is prize given to which kosha? Vijnanamaya kosha. And some other places for literature and for most moving poetry and so on, for Grammy awards and Oscar awards and so on. To an extent, they are manomaya kosha too, for their emotional richness. Art is said to be more towards heart, manomaya kosha, feelings, emotions. Science is said to be by and large closer to the vijnanamaya. And there are other competitions, eating competition. Who eats maximum doklas? South India it is idlis. North may be roti or puri. So to an extent it is annamaya kosha, the glory of annamaya kosha. Plus pranamaya is involved in that also, combination. Is there any appreciation anywhere of the pure self? Nobody bothers. Half the world doesn't believe in it at all. Then those who believe in it also have vague idea. That's the fourth line. Shrutvapi, even though you have heard, studied, even taught, you have dealt with it, this Atma Tattva. But shrutva api, shravaitva api, having studied, having taught, naveda kaschit. Nobody really bothers much. In no time, your attention gets distracted, diverted to something grosser. To stay with the subtle is very hard. So is the society's pull and push also. Therefore, many a man finds it good excuse. I wanted to stay with the subtle, but there is no scope in this society for it. Nobody cares, nobody bothers, nobody values. Many a singer sacrifices classical music, goes for some, what do you call it when you combine two things? Fusion music. So you make fusion music. We speakers also unnecessarily talk about management and this and that, and then blame it on audiences. The audience want the such things only. What is that? There is a saying in almost every language. The dancer who could not dance blamed it upon the dance floor, that it was teda. Nachana? Nachana jane angan theda. Yes, in Kannada we have kunil bardi rodu neladonku anlante. There is a saying like that. I am sure Gujarati and Telugu and Konkani, everywhere it is there. Nachana jane angan theda. In all fields it happens. from the spiritual philosophical point of view, it is your lack of vairagya. You should not be attached to quick results. You should not be attached to fast buck. You should do an aradhana of your subject, your field, what you admire, what you adore, whether it is Vedanta or Sangeeta or Vijnana, any language, botany, environment, anything. Do an aradhana, do an upasana of it, whether you get appreciation or not. Then you can go very far, that is called uparati, swadharma nishtha. Bahyana lambanam vrittehe esho parati uttama. All of us are doing bahyana lambanam. Bahya, not analambanam, we are doing bahya alambanam. So anuparati, no withdrawal. At the throwing of a hat, we go for paradharma because of some glitter, some glamour. On one hand, we criticize those who compromise, we ourselves compromise. If you closely examine your life, you will find that every time you criticize somebody, you will find you also are doing that in another way, maybe on another level sometimes. You may criticize poor people for not being cleanliness conscious. Yes, they are doing terrible things, spitting everywhere, peeing everywhere, so on and so forth. With that you do not do, but on your level you too are compromising. Somebody else on their own level. So is cleanliness is a physical thing in context of values and so on. So it's extremely hard to stay with swadharma. Shri Krishna's teaching, swadharme nidhanam shreyah paradharma bhayavahah, is a very powerful teaching. Perhaps millions of books have been written in the West, in the East, everywhere, which slightly reworded are a commentary on swadharma only. So many movies, so many plays, all have finally the message of swadharma. If you are with swadharma, there is true excellence in your life. Otherwise, the glitter and glamour, the quick buck, etc., gives you respectability. In fact, Krishnamurti uses the word respectability. So many things that humanity does, he says, is not out of love, not out of understanding, but out of quickly seeing what is respectable by doing what people will talk well of me. My name will come in the paper, I will also become a member of important circles. So going for respectability, people make their choices. Lot of people study Vedanta also because it is respectable. It is embarrassing to say in some circles, I don't know anything about Geeta. That is when in Hindi you have that expression, thoda pad lete hain. Padna is one thing, but pad lete hain. There at least it means you are not willing, but you will read it for some other benefit. Theek hai? आप सब गीता पढ़ते हैं तो हम भी थोड़ा पढ़ लेते हैं, क्या बिगड़ता है. दैट स्पिरिट, देयरफॉर वन इज नॉट एबल टू अप्रिशिएट. द फर्स्ट सेंटेंस आई थिंक इज वेल मेड. हार्डली एनी ग्रेट सोल, आई डोंट नो व्हाई ग्रेट सोल इज सेड, एनी सोल कुड हैव बीन इनफ. हार्डली एनी पर्सन, एनीबॉडी परसीव्स दिस सोल एज मार्वेलस. एनीबॉडी speaks of it as marvelous. Anyaha aascharyavat tathaiva vadati. Ashcharyavat Anyaha Shrinoti. As you studied it a while ago in the Kathopanishad, the mantra pretty much like this, maybe with one or two words difference, came there also. In fact, it is difficult to know what exactly Shri Krishna meant, as I admitted right at the beginning. This shloka can be interpreted in many ways, but the most common interpretation is this rarity. Hardly anyone. There it was said, Ashcharyo Vakta Kushalo Kushalanu Shishtaha Ashcharya Shrota and so on. Shravanayapi Bahubir Yona Labhyaha. That is how it began there. This is a slightly modified version of Kathopanishad mantra. It suffices to say that this is a writing on the wall in one sense. The pure self, the true nature of every one of us is in one sense undoubtedly the most marvelous thing. Alas, in spite of it, the shloka says, in spite of it being so wonderful, it's extremely rare to find anybody opting for it. Everyone lets go of the Atma Jnana. All are signing up, all are subscribing, all are opting for, choosing a million other things in the world, in life, and nobody wants Atma Jnana. This also, upon being thought of or thought over deeply, can give great vairagya. Non-attachment can arise out of contemplation on this shloka. Shri Krishna himself summarizes the 20 verses people in the Ambaji camp studied in the 30th verse. Dehi nityam avadyaha. The word nityam could mean not only always at all time, but asamshayam. Nityam means undoubtedly the indweller in the body. Dehe yaha tishtati. Dehi, the word is explained as dehaha or deham asya asti iti dehi. One who has the body, embodied soul. The embodied soul, have no doubt whatsoever, is indestructible. The whole 20 verses are about the indestructible self. Even as Arjuna was worried about death on both the Kaurava and Pandava camps, Shri Krishna shakes the very foundation of his worries, saying, there is no death. No death. People have commented on this. Was it necessary for Shri Krishna to suddenly go to that height? He could have begun with small steps. To totally dismiss death itself. And was Arjuna fit for this? Was he an adhikari? He was not Nachiketa, he was not a viragi. He should have been taught karma yoga only. There are some people who say that whole Bhagavad Gita should have been only about karma yoga, because that was the medicine Arjuna needed. As the disease, so must be the medicine. If you have cold or fever, you go to doctor. A doctor should not show all the medicine that he has with him. I have cancer medicine, I have BP medicine, I have diabetes medicine. And in between, by the way, for you, fever medicine is the best. But take a look at this medicine that I have. You know, this man is saying, I am having fever. Yes, I will give you fever medicine. But pregnant women take this. The man says, but I am not pregnant. Right? So, according to some commentators or some critics or some people, whoever, the Gita could have been only karma yoga. Because what Arjuna needed was karma yoga. But in justification of how Shri Krishna began and in justification of how Shri Krishna later also intersperses teachings of karma yoga with teachings of jnana yoga, he goes up and down, back and forth, bhakti, yoga. He gives a very comprehensive coverage of all the approaches in Indian wisdom. In justification of it, we say that Arjuna was not a robot. He was not a machine. He was not an idiot. He was a very intelligent, eminent, educated, bright person. For a bright person, you not only have to give an idea of what he should do, but you should put it in perspective. You should see that other options are there. You should give him a taste of varieties of looking at the problem, and from his heart there should be the voice coming out, yes, now I am able to put everything in proper place and I think I should do this. Otherwise he would imagine that something was sold to me, something cheap was sold to me. He would not be convinced. And what is more, now coming to how Shri Krishna, please know that this is the beginning of Gita. Gita begins with this portion which we have studied. The idea of starting with Atmajnana is to give a shock to Arjuna, shock treatment. Having shaken him that there is no death at all, what are you talking? Then he can be given appropriate medicine. Dehi nityam avadyaha sarvasya dehe, in everybody. Tasmat sarvani bhutani avadhyani, is understood. All living beings are indestructible. Nothing ever happens when you rise to the plane of pure awareness. When you are on the lower plane of thoughts, emotions, Swamiji would say OET, PFT. On the lower level, lot of things are happening. Nisargadatta, in your world, so many things are happening. In my world, nothing happens, he said. What a powerful statement. Dehi nityam avadyaha is no other than that blissful, intelligent way of seeing things. There is no fear. You are ever secure. You don't need a big job and a big bungalow and also all this what the world offers. They are all unnecessary. You are fine anywhere and everywhere. And if you are serving in some capacity somewhere, that is incidental. With the wisdom of the Gita, you and I would be feeling unconditionally secure. The import of this, or the purport of this shloka, is unconditional security. In worldly life, we are feeling somewhat okay because alright, some income I have and there is some FDs also are there, and then not bad, I have a few good friends. So looking at our possessions and position and some of those things, we feel not bad. Somebody asks us, how are you? We say, pulling on. Kaise ho? Chal raha hai. Zindagi chal rahi hai. This is the kind of answer we give. But the Gita's wisdom, if we were to own it, would give us unconditional security. If we draw a salary, if we are keeping some FDs, if we are having some property, if we are keeping some social circle, it is incidental. Incidental meaning, without it also we are fine. They are secondary. All of them are secondary. In fact, all of them are a medium for us to express our love, a medium. They are not the medium. if by chance they go, we will find some other medium. We will find some other ways of expressing the love in our heart. Work then becomes a medium for self-expression, not something to lean on. Without somebody, without some work, without something, we would not be lost. That is the meaning of avadhya. It is not so much about physically being killed. The clinical death is not the primary concern of the Vedanta. Dialogue with death is not so much about clinical death, but it is the fear of clinical death or fear of losing our identity is tackled, and then we learn the art of dying to narrowness, dying to egoism. It is the mystical death of the ego resulting or leading to the birth of the pure self. Let's read Prapanna Parijataya again to conclude these Gita discourses together. Prapanna Parijataya Totra Vetraika Panaye Jnana Mudraya Krishnaya Gitamrita Duhe Namaha Harihi Om.